I'm delighted to be joined here today by Professor Andrew Crane, who is the George R. Gardner Professor of Business Ethics and Director of the Centre of Excellence in Responsible Business at the Schulich School of Business at York University in Toronto, Canada. Welcome, Andy.
Thank you, Mark. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, great. Well, you've done a lot of research and writing in stakeholder theory, and my students have actually been reading one of your co-authored articles on the topic. And so for postgrad students who are relatively new to this theory, would you mind just giving a nutshell summary for them?
Sure. I mean, stakeholder theory is a pretty simple idea in many respects. You know, it's really about the idea that corporations in particular are not just there to serve the interests of shareholders. So stakeholder theory was designed to give us a way of thinking about other ways of understanding both the ownership of corporations, but in particular how decisions should be made. So who should be involved in decision making, and how should the benefits that are driven by corporations, the values created by them, who should it go to? So stakeholder theory is really about those sorts of questions. So who can affect organizations, but also, you know, who is affected by them, and what sort of rights that they have in respect to that stake that they have, how should they be consulted, how should they be involved in decision making, and those sorts of things. So it's a very broad theory, and I saw that in one of your other readings you have the paper What Stakeholder Theory Is Not, you know, because there's a whole set of different ways of understanding what it is. You know, it's a very simple idea. There are multiple constituencies in any organization, but then when it comes to us tax of, well, who's actually included, and what are the implications of that? Then it becomes a much broader discussion about what is the purpose of corporations.
Yes, and we see that at its simplest level, I guess it's just simply a matter of stakeholders being there to serve the interests of a company, and the main stakeholders being the shareholders, the customers, and the corporate directors. Really, your article and the other one you mentioned certainly extends that a lot further, and it enters that corporate ethics field where a company and its decisions have so many more stakeholders' interests at play.
Exactly.
Mm. So coming to your article, which starts to talk about social identity and basically presenting a grid which shows some intersection of what might be seen as a traditional role in relation to a corporation and other social roles someone might play. Would you mind just talking us through the basic principles there in your spin on that?
Mm. Sure. Yeah, I mean, the basic way we understand stakeholders is always about the kind of interaction they have with the firm. So we think about them either as customers, as employees, as suppliers, as regulators or NGOs or whatever else they might be. You know, this typical kind of transactional view of who those different constituencies are. But the reason why different groups may actually mobilize or try and gain legitimacy in relation to a firm, how they might press their claims, you know, the kind of state that they think they have, is not always about those simple transactions that they're engaged with. You know, the reasons people do things, the reasons people collect together to collaborate and press their claims upon firms are also about who people believe they are, right? About their social identity. So what are the bonds that connect me to other people that means these are the things that bring people together and make them mobilize in a social movement or some sort of pressure towards companies. So, you know, it may well be that I'm a customer of a firm, but I might simultaneously be also an employee. I might also hold shares in that firm. You know, I've got all kinds of different relationships with the firm at any one time. What we try and do with social identity theory with that paper is to say, well, when people actually do try and press their claims, it's often about who we feel connected to that's important. So the fact that, you know, I'm a white British male, for example, who lives in Canada, that is very important for why I may be involved, why I might connect with certain firms. For example, it might be very different if I was a woman or a person of colour or any other kind of quality that might impact upon how I connect with companies.
Hmm. Well, it seems, because of that very reason, to lend itself to an examination of social media in relation to a corporation, and particularly perhaps during an emerging crisis, because people with different social identities might fluctuate towards social media for different reasons and in different places. So have you thought yourself about the interaction with stakeholder theory and social media in the corporation?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the important ways of connecting up stakeholder theory with social media as well, if a firm is trying to work out who it should be communicating with through social media, who are the constituencies that are important, stakeholder theory provides a framework for that, right? It gives us a way of thinking through who are the legitimate constituencies that we should be connecting with, how can we distinguish between legitimate and illegitimate, and also between who are the more powerful or less powerful that we should be connecting with. You know, stakeholder theory is often seen in very instrumental terms in that sense. There's a very strong instrumental approach there, which says, you know, firms will care about stakeholders that matter, those that have power, those that have legitimacy, those whose stakes are very urgent. So, you know, social media is all about power in many respects, right? It's about who you can influence, who you can connect to, how many people are in, you know, in your list of Twitter followers and what have you. So for firms, it provides a framework for them to establish who matters in terms of their different constituencies. But if we take it in ethical dimension, take a more normative perspective, we're going to think, well, what rights do those people then have? Right? What sort of rights do you have as an employee, as a consumer, as a broader stakeholder of an organization in relation to how it's going to communicate to you, you know, in terms of protection of privacy, protection of various rights in terms of bullying and other things that can happen through social media?
Yes, and I think also it can catch some corporations by surprise if they haven't thought through particular social media stakeholders or people who are using social media who may be stakeholders. And we see this with these grassroots campaigns against major corporations where they've underestimated the power of public momentum and social conscience using social media, which fits with your social identity perspective on that, doesn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I think one of the interesting things here is that, you know, we tend to think about stakeholders in terms of a hub and a spokes, right? That here's the firm, here's the decision-making unit, and here's the employees, here's the consumers, here's the suppliers, here's the others. But social media is all about interconnections, right, between different stakeholders, between different groups, that you can't think in those terms anymore. If you're trying to understand social media. So stakeholder theory has limits in its traditional view for understanding it, unless you take it to a much more networked, much more nuanced kind of understanding of the types of environments that firms are interacting with.
Well, while stakeholder theory might be very useful in research and the academy in looking at corporations and their interaction with various stakeholders, how useful is it as a practical tool in an organization? Say if you're a marketing manager or a public relations manager and you wish to avert some crisis in your company by trying to ascertain who the various stakeholders are and their respective interests.
I mean, it can be very useful. It depends how you use it. It can be very effective at, you know, helping firms to become prepared for identifying the various constituencies they need to be concerned about. If you take it seriously, you need to be creative about trying to imagine who those constituencies are, because it's not just who is going to affect you now, but if you think about a particular decision, who is likely to be affected further down the line. So it can help you to identify these constituencies. But it can also help you to start thinking about, well, how can we predict what the type of response will be from those constituencies, depending upon how much power they have, how much influence, leverage, whether they're connected to other stakeholders in ways that mean they can leverage even greater influence and those sorts of things. Mm-hmm. So you can start to predict the kind of responses that may happen based on, you know, a simple kind of stakeholder framework, that then gets into the idea of who has power, who can influence what's going to happen to the firm.
And would you see it fitting in any way into the planning and drafting of a social media policy within an organisation?
Certainly, yes. I mean, both in terms of identifying who should be included in that policy, but perhaps more importantly, who should be involved in actually even devising the policy. The stakeholder theory is all about who should be involved in decision-making. So, you know, the question will be, can we just set up a policy and then kind of send it out and everyone's going to abide by it? Well, realistically, that's not how social media works, is it? It's a very unruly kind of phenomenon. So it's also about thinking, well, who should be involved in decision-making here? Who are the parties that are affected by this? And with our social identity cut on it, this is not just, okay, we need to involve our employees or we need to involve our consumers, but what particular subgroups of those employees or consumers might we need to be concerned with? So, you know, Facebook had its kind of big issues with the lesbian, gay and bisexual and trans community, you know, a couple of years ago, by making sure that everyone had their real name as part of their Facebook profiles. And then, you know, this community was saying that they wanted also to express other identities using other names. So if you don't have those groups involved when you're setting the policy in the first place, it creates all kinds of problems down the line when you realize you've upset a core constituency without thinking what it is that that binds them together in terms of their identity.
Well, that's terrific. Thanks, Professor Crane. It's great to have one of the authors of our readings talking to us about the subject matter at hand, and I really thank you for your time today.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, thanks so much.